don't have to worry, cause baby, there ain't no mountain.
Need some air guitar, air guitar.
Ain't no
This is a bass and drum song. That's what makes
there
it
you
good.
Go. I know. We can't all even make it with sections. Our air guitar. Mojo Monday, Rick, how are you?
I'm awesome, Brett. Thanks. Mojo Monday to you, my friend. Yeah. Mojo Monday to all of our friends listening in.
Yes. So my favorite time of the week. I think it's just an exciting time to kick the week off, a little mindset and a little all that fun stuff, right?
100%. Let's put some energy into it and launch it right.
I love it. So I wanted to read you real quick. I looked up the word mojo. We've been doing this for a couple weeks now. And mojo is defined as a magic spell, a hex or charm, a magical power. And the way they used it in the word is he worked his mojo on the tennis court, or the team has lost its mojo. So today, mojo is really... what's that secret power, that magical power that we bring to our mindset that really kicks our week off and lets us live in our personal power, right?
That's it. It's about being your personal best and having mojo inside your heart and mind so that the rest of the world reciprocates.
There you go. So here we are. We're in session two of our six personal perspective series. Real quick, why don't you just kind of give me your take? What are these things? What are the six personal perspectives?
I mean, I'm sure you're going to post the list, but they're...
Yeah.
Yeah, so commitment to self-mastery, commit to the 80-20, moving from E to P, make learning base the foundation for your action plan, removing limiting beliefs, and then becoming more accountable. And we talked about committing to self-mastery and the importance of waking up every day hungry and thirsty for self-developing to your highest potential. And today we're going to move into the 80-20 principle, which is Pareto's law from the 1600s. And you want to jump in on that?
Yeah, I just, before we do though, the six personal perspectives in my word, you really kind of understand that to be a top producer or a best in class, if you will, you're going to fight your mindset along that journey. And you want to win. And these are how to win in that mindset battle that we all go through, right? You have an emotional battle. You got to make sure your emotional state gets to where you need to be. But our mind can be a very powerful thing. And these are the principles or the perspectives, I should say, of what mastery looks like or success looks like. And it's just such a simple but powerful conversation for all of us, right?
You're exactly right. Education, opportunity, awareness, and then actionable steps towards each of these perspectives will convert you into a different person over time.
Yeah. So here we are. We're the second six personal perspective is to commit to the 80-20 principle. And there's this famous guy that actually created this and named it after Pareto. I forget his first name. It's like it starts with a B.
It's Alfredo or Benedicto.
But Pareto is what everybody refers to as the Pareto's principle. And why don't you give me your definition of it?
Yeah, I mean, what I understand is that back in the 1600s, he was a student of the game and an economist, and he studied his village somewhere deep in the recesses of Italy and realized that 80% of all wealth in his village and his community resided in 20% of the pockets or the people. Right. And so he recognized that wealth was not equally proportionately distributed. And then there was a distinct disproportionate reality that showed up in money. And then as he continued to study the disproportionate reality of resources and control and wealth and even influence, he realized that it existed across just about every area of life.
Yeah. And I think we use this 80-20 rule, and some people even kind of get forward thinking and say, well, sometimes it's a 90-10 and da 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 da. But the reality is there's kind of two concepts to it. There's a people concept, and then there's an activity concept. And what I mean by that is, in his context, he was saying 20% of the people in this Italian demographic had 80% of the wealth, right? Yep. And you can always flip it and say, that means the 80% of the people had 20% of the wealth. And I think society really kind of functions this way. I mean, it's not exact, obviously, but it's a general rule of thumb. And then it takes us in, Rick, to this second part of this principle or perspective, which is around activities. And the way I would explain it is, you know, Rick, if you wrote down the 100 things you're going to do today on a piece of paper, in theory, we could go back and circle 20 of those 100 and go, those are the money makers. Those are the ones that are going to put money in your pocket, right? At the highest rate of return. Yet, that doesn't mean the other 80 things on that piece of paper shouldn't get done, right? You still got to get all 100 done. Yep. And I think that's where people get hung up on this, because the coaching conversation is not do the 20 and don't do the 80, right? What's the conversation?
I mean, the conversation in my mind, Brett, is how do you best put your skill set and talent, and your core genius to work in a way that creates the highest and best return? If in your business, it's lead generation and it's, you know, showing homes and writing contracts and negotiating opportunities and, you know, marketing and lead gen, those are clearly high level behavioral components and of success of a salesperson. Doesn't mean you don't need to go pick up bread, milk, and, you know, and butter
from off the dry cleaning,
you know, or pick up, but that doesn't mean it has to be you and it doesn't have to be first. And so when you think 80-20, I would challenge everyone to look at their day planner for the last few weeks, maybe go back a month and highlight, you know, in red where you know you weren't doing the 80 or the 20, not sure what you're doing. Maybe use another highlighter color like, you know, yellow and circle the 80%. And then green light the things where you are in your A game, where your hour or your dollar productive was $100 an hour or more in terms of equatable income against the effort and behavior that you're exercising.
Yeah. And at the end of the day, it's like sometimes we started this conversation with that battle we go through in our mind, right? And some of those things on the 80%, we start making statements like, well, nobody's going to do it as good as I can, or hey, I actually enjoy doing some of these things. And those statements in that battle in our mind is actually what keeps us from our personal power and staying prioritized and focused on the things that take our life and make it go like this, right?
Yeah, the secret is to recognize what you could and segregate out of that what you should. And that's really straight from, you know, Stephen Covey and the one thing from Gary Keller, who talks about even inside of the 80-20, there's an 80-20 and an 80-20. And if you take your 80-20 and you end up with 20 things, Brett, as 100, and you take the 80-20 again, and yet one more time, you'll end up with the one thing. And
yeah, well, it goes the 80-20 to 20 priorities, and then the 80-20, that's your five big rocks. Yep. And then the 80-20 of that's your one thing, right?
Yeah. And sometimes people, to your point, get comfortable doing things that aren't the one thing because it's just easier, more rewarding. I'm convicted in the belief that people create lists so that they can check them off and at the end of the day feel good about themselves. And there's nothing wrong with that. But if you treat all things equally, there's a chance you miss the big rock that really pays the biggest, you know, potential dividend.
So I'm going to ask you a tough question, but why do we struggle with this? And we talked a little bit about it, but this is, I think this is one of those principles or perspectives we all at some point in our life hear and learn and know about and we're aware of, right? But it's not as easily practiced as it is learned.
Yeah, I mean, there's two aspects in my mind. One is identifying the 20 and getting really clear about what it is. And maybe not everybody gets it, you know, but one way to think about it is, you know, when you go through your day plan and you analyze what you were doing, did it lead to a commission, a sale, or income? And or a quantum leap moment in life. It's not always money. Some 20% lie. And like, even in exercise, there are certain efficiencies that you can exercise in a shorter period of time and gain greater results versus random exercise. Like working with a trainer, you could put me in a training environment for 30 minutes and I guarantee you I'd get more physical effort and outcome from it than if I were on my own for 2 hours. And so there's an example of being very proactive and calculating in my approach. So part of it's identifying. The other part is prioritizing and owning that reality and actually doing it. And again, some of it goes back to maybe fear of failure. And maybe you avoid the hard things because you just want to clock a few successes early. And then it's lunchtime and then you clock a few more successes, which the 80% are always, in my humble opinion, they're typically easier. And so, and then you missed the big rock, and then you didn't play to win at the highest level.
Yeah. Now I'm going to throw the term mastery in here for a minute. We've talked many times around how you have to spend 10,000 hours on a task to make your way to mastery. It comes out of the book Outliers, and Talent is Overrated, and those concepts. But the way it relates to this principle and this perspective is, if you don't have focus on your 20%, time is going to become a crunch for you. And on your journey to mastery, you're not going to ever get there, because you're not going to have spent enough time on the activities that you're looking to master that are going to take your life and take it off like a rocket ship, right?
Agreed. I think one of the greatest gifts and curses on the planet, Brett, is being good at most things, or sometimes even thinking of yourself as a master of all things, or capable of all things, maybe not a master. And by being good at all things, you have a harder time delegating, and it comes back again to control. But at the end of the day, if you try to be good at everything, you're going to become average at everything, and average at everything doesn't pay the highest residual gain.
Yeah. You know, Pareto used some terms to quote him. He said, the 20% people were the vital few, and the remaining 80% were the trivial many. And man, I don't want to live my life in the trivial many. I'd rather be defined as a vital few.
Yeah. Well, and to be the vital few, you have to be good at something where others follow. And that sometimes requires leverage, and leverage can be outsourced. It can be subcontracted. It can be anytime you can take something that's not part of that vital few things that make all of the difference. You know, and the truth too is that few people will do it. So if you're the one doing it, others will follow, knowing that, you know, the breadcrumbs you leave are going to feed a family. And so getting really good and mastering the vital few things that make a difference in your career and life, it's a game changer.
Yeah.
What do you think beat that frog, and like, how do you approach the vital few?
Yeah. I mean, I wouldn't dare stand here and say I'm perfect on it. Right. Because we fight this journey in our minds. Right. And that's what the mindset battle really is. But there's so many business studies like Eat That Frog, you mentioned, that Brian Tracy wrote a book on, which is basically going after the big things first. Right. And he references them as the frog. Then there's the Eisenhower matrix, which is understanding what's important and urgent versus non-important and non-urgent, and really positioning the things in your life around how to handle them, whether to decide, delegate, delete, or you know, all those fun things. And all that being said, we study all this stuff, and it's really just comes down to here and here. And knowing what we need to focus on, and put in that emotional energy and effort to those things.
Right.
And how do I do it?
Yeah.
A time block is one of the tricks that we all fight, but learn, right? Accountability is one of the tricks that we all learn and fight. And really, if we know what our best life needs to look like, it goes back to what you and I talked about last week. How do we make it fit us? And that's really what self-mastery is, right?
You're exactly right. And it's about prioritizing in a way that you get subconscious wins in the urgent and the back to that, you know, the vital, not the trivial. And so your subconscious brain knows exactly what you should do. We all have sonar, Brett. We all know. We wake up feeling the energy, and then we, you know, we let ourselves off the hook. We derail, we disengage, we allow distraction. So, you know, from MREA, build a bunker, man. That's like a huge, you know, shift actually. And vital first step is to build a bunker and eliminate the noise long enough to do the vital few things, and then let the rest of the day take care of itself. And I'm reminded Tim Heil was at Mega Camp when he was 23 or 4 years old, a young guy right out of college. I think everyone knows the Heil Group, H-E-Y-L. Google him inside of command, watch some videos. The kid's brilliant. He's not a kid anymore. He's probably 30 something. But back then I remember thinking, man, what a brilliant way to approach life. And Gary had him on stage because he was one of the early MREA agents and also under 25, which was astounding, a millionaire income-producing realtor. And he said, how do you do it, Tim? And he said, I get up every day and I do nothing other than call people until I set 3 appointments every day. And he said, how long does that take? He goes, it can be 3, 4, or 5 hours. And it doesn't matter how long it takes. I don't stop till I have my appointments. He says, well, how does your afternoon look like? He goes, that's when I go on appointments. And he said, well, there's a lot of stuff that comes into play in your world. What do you do with that? And he said, well, if I set the right number of appointments and I go on enough appointments, I create a lot of chaos. And I've generated enough income from that chaos now to pay a chaos manager to take care of the detail. And I thought, man, what a perfect description of how the 80-20, you know, mindset wise, jump on the big rocks, take your appointments and let someone else pick up the pieces.
Yep. And to that example, it becomes somebody else's 20%. Your 80% is somebody else's 20%. And they're better at it. Like, I do not need to be creating my own income tax returns. It is not my 20%, but it is my CPA's 20%. And that's how he makes his money, right?
Well, and I'd visit you in IRS jail if you did.
Don't go there. But so here we go. So, you know, most of our listeners are real estate agents, and the 20% newsflash is really lead generation in the real estate industry. But, you know, you do an exercise, Rick, with the Wheel of Life, and you always take you ask us to rate ourselves in all these different areas of our life. And then you always ask a couple key questions. And what I know you're doing, or I think you're doing, is you're really trying to help us see what are the 20% activities in all those areas around the life, right? On the life wheel.
Well, it's near impossible to have a holistic, successful life if you try to master everything. But if you live inside the 20% of each of those 12 categories as often as possible, you'll land exactly where you're supposed to and become your better, higher powered version of yourself.
Yeah.
So it's about fewer things that are more relevant and important than it is more things to prove that you checked a big list.
You know, the more and more I live life, the more I realize there's nothing new really under the sun, right? We just learn it in different contexts and all that stuff. So yeah. My hope is that this is not new information to you. It's a reminder to you that this is such a powerful perspective to move you to the top of the field, right, towards mastery, and to change the trajectory of your life. Because the irony, Rick, is if you're not in the 20%, you're in the 80% fighting over 20% of the business, right?
Yeah, you're fighting for scraps and leftovers.
Yeah. So how should we challenge everybody this week? I think I would go into the Wheel of Life and pick the two or three areas that you feel you need the most improvement on and get clarity around those 20% activities in those two or three areas, right?
Yeah. And then support it with a conviction that you're going to honor that commitment by putting it in your day planner and having a non-negotiable appointment with yourself relative to that exact behavior or that opportunity to live into that space.
Yep. And if you're in the real estate industry, I hope you choose lead generation as one of your 20%.
Well, and I'll say this, Brett, if you're not sure what to do, go back to Ignite and pull the 210-40. Excuse me. Yeah, the daily 10-4, easy for me to say. There's so many acronyms in our company. And connect with 10 people, put 10 people in your database, send 10 thank you notes, and meet people, put them in your database. Oh, preview 10 houses. If you do that every day for a month, I promise you, your business will be robust in 30 days.
Yeah.
So preview 10 houses, meet 10 new people, put them in your database and 10 thank you notes.
Awesome. Which is basically 20% activities, right?
Basically lead gen.
Yeah, basically lead gen. And it doesn't matter if you're a $100 million producer or a brand new agent, lead generation is the 20% activity in our industry. And you're either lead generating for buyers and sellers, or ultimately you start lead generating for talent in your organization to take you to the next level. So Rick, that's their challenge, my friend. And we are here every Monday. It is Mojo Monday. Give me a parting thought.
Just because you can doesn't mean you should. Make sure you live in the space that gives you the highest and best return. If you do that, you'll have lots of margin to do the fun stuff you just want to do because you want to do it, because you'll fund a big life.
Rick, you're always wise. Happy Mojo Monday.
You too, my friend. Hope everybody has an amazing week.
know.